Thanks. Well, Ido, here we are again.
Yes.
Good to see you. I want to kick it off with, you have this vision of a different healthcare model where it's really around the consumer or the patient getting access to the right reimbursement, getting access to the right care 24/7. You know, give me a little bit about your vision and where you see this going in the next couple of years.
Absolutely. The good news is that it's not my vision. I think more and more people are assigned to this notion. We know the current healthcare infrastructure is broken. We know technology can help. And I think many agree that the new model of care is truly emerging. We are beginning to see not an evolution, but rather a revolution. In essence, you can call it consumerism in healthcare or many other names. But the basic idea is that we are going to have much more information as a basis for any type of intervention. From our bodies, we'll see millions of signals emitting continuously. In the cloud, this data will be analyzed and made available to a combination of risk-bearing providers and payers, and interventions are going to be executed at the most convenient location, which often is the home. Realizing this vision is not something that any one company can do. It requires a very broad, integrated coalition. And what we are doing together is really at the foundation of this coalition to try to create a platform to realize a good solution for this unmet need.
So I hung out with my son this weekend, and he works with BCG Digital Ventures. So I asked him, you know, what industries are you addressing? And he said, well, the first thing we look at is there a very fragmented experience? And then the second thing we look at, is there a lot of waste in the system? So I said, well, boy, do I have an industry for you. So I think a lot of what we're jointly looking at is how can we give that seamless experience where you not only give your providers the right information about you to do the right intervention at the right time with what you're saying, but how can you also use that information yourself to take better control of your own health? And then as and when needed, you can reach out to a provider and actually want to know whether you're being reimbursed for that. So it's kind of flipping the model. And I've been thinking about our own business. You know, we have a great sleep and respiratory care business. But a lot of the people who suffer from sleep apnea are not aware of the fact that they're actually, it's one of the underdiagnosed diseases. So I started thinking, what if we can help people kind of self-diagnose and then, you know, find out whether they're getting reimbursed for sleep apnea and who would be the best provider and how to engage with that provider. And, you know, I immediately thought of American Well. I said, well, that would be ideal if we work with you on that and then create this sleep ecosystem, not just sleep apnea, but really helping people to control their sleep, because it really impacts how you live and it impacts chronic disease. So how do you see these kind of ecosystems play out that we can address together?
Absolutely. I mean, in essence, I think the biggest question is a question of infrastructure, and the use cases are easy. People are attracted to immediately find a solution for a silo and missing out on the need for an infrastructure.
Yeah.
Some of the important assumptions for American Well and Philips are to define our role in a way that is not disruptive. And what do I mean by that? Many people try to replace your doctor in a call center or things of that matter. We don't think that that will ever work. We think that our role in the ecosystem is to connect to the doctors that you trust. Other people are trying to create new financial models to replace the payers that have a lot of tools to truly understand risk. We also think that that won't work. In the future, there is still a role for the provider that I trust and the payer that is managing my risk. We also believe that no one company should become the Amazon of healthcare, if you will. Essentially, Amazon is pretty good at offering choice to consumers. Samsung, Apple, Facebook are where people are. Our role in the ecosystem is not try to become them. Our role in the ecosystem is to try to allow consumers that use those consumer outlets in order to integrate and connect with the people that we trust in a solution that is trustworthy. What makes me really exciting about Philips, and the list is quite long, is not only that Philips is an amazing, innovative company with a legacy of that goes back to hundreds of years ago, I think.
127 days.
Thank you. 127 years. Invented the color TV and CD and many other amazing things. But Philips has a DNA of deep understanding of the consumer alongside with deep asset and understanding of the provider. And that's very rare. And if you take those assets together and connect it to the connector infrastructure of American Well, you get something pretty powerful that mirrors a platform. And then you can use it for Ugro, and you can use it for sleep, and you can use it for diabetes. An infinite number of use cases that could leverage and grow this solution. The difference between a solution and a platform is that a solution has a very clear unmet need and provides a very good infrastructure to solve it. A platform is an infrastructure that takes something really complicated that nobody really wants to do. Real-time adjudication, privacy, scalability, security, and makes it really simple for the ecosystem. Samsung, a great partner, doesn't want necessarily to understand reimbursement in healthcare. And we help them do that. The Apple Heart Study wanted to conduct a very smooth transition between a watch, a phone, and an intervention. And we made it really easy for them to do that. What we are going to do together, it makes this platform even more robust and more connected to truly align around the new model of healthcare.
Well, I'm really excited about it, and thanks for being such a great marketeer for Philips. What we've been talking about is, you know, half of the population has chronic disease or is very high risk of chronic disease, and you know, chronic disease is with you 24/7, and probably for the rest of your life. You know. So I think the other thing that you and I have been discussing, which I believe is really powerful, if we can create this secure network of medical devices, we can create a longitudinal view of the patient or of the consumer where all the relevant information is just streaming in there and it's getting interpreted and pushed back out as tools for patients and providers. With the right, you know, mechanism, the right platform to bring it together all at the right time and the right place. And as you rightly said, you know, there's no single organization that's going to solve it. Apple is not going to solve it. Amazon is not going to solve it. Amazon, Berkshire Hathaway, and JP Morgan are not going to solve it. But together, we have a good shot at this. And I think, as you say, if we really, really center this on the consumer, on the patient, and if we make sure that we connect that patient with the right, you know, specialist, and that can be in the hospital, it will most probably be more in the home than the hospital in the future, but also, you know, to prep the patient better for a procedure, to help the patient better after the procedure, after he's being discharged from the procedure. So I also look at to us working together on this, you know, post-discharge world where you have to really keep track of the patient, make sure that when they're at home, they still can be monitored. And, you know, we're showing some really exciting stuff here. So we have our wearable sensor that we first positioned in the general ward. So you can do continuous monitoring on 7 vital signs, including fall detection. But now we are allowing the patient to bring that home and then use our joint platform to monitor those people at home. I think it's going to make a real difference in the way care is provided.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, essentially, there's no factory for doctors. The gap between the number of doctors and the growing aging population is just going to increase. What we are doing together is allowing doctors to very effectively treat patients who are not in the room. And that's very important because many telehealth solutions help people get a quick access to a doctor and a script. And while that sounds really similar, it's very, very different. We all know that AI is important in order to automate anything that can be automated, so the scarce resources of providers can be used in the most effective way when consideration is required. But no automation will replace trust. We're humans.
Yeah.
I don't want to hear from a machine that I have Hodgkin lymphoma. I want a person to tell me that. And I want someone to guide me through this process. But I also believe that if I have been living in Chattanooga, Tennessee all my life, I deserve the best protocol that was invented in Cleveland Clinic or in another territory national center to be available to me. What we are doing together is truly democratizing healthcare. We're taking the best algorithms, the best analytics, the best information, and making it available to people so we can truly improve outcomes, improve convenience, and provide great service to our parents and our children in their home.
So if you, you know, I talked to some of the large integrated delivery networks here, and people tell me, you know, if we can just make sure that only the right people get into the hospital, the people that really need to have very specialized care, very complex procedures, or very acute care. And if we can do everybody else outside the hospital, we can take hundreds of millions out of our P&L. So the whole concept not only makes total sense from a patient perspective, getting the right care at the right time at the right place, I think it also makes a lot of sense from a provider perspective where they can optimize their own, you know, scarce resources. And of course, many doctors, especially specialists, you want to optimize, you know, their time with patients. And, you know, you can see that the whole virtualization is a real important movement. So what you see here on the stand as well is our digital pathology solution. So today, most pathologists have to be close to the tissue. So they look at a cancerous tissue, they put it under a microscope and they do their diagnosis, which is critical to the overall diagnosis of the cancer and the selection of the therapy. But let's say you have a guy who specializes in brain tumor.
Yep.
So now we say, hey, you can put the digital pathology machine in the lab, you can digitize the tissue, and then you can send it to the network, in the network, to the pathologist that's really the specialist in brain tumor, let him do the diagnosis, aided by AI, because now we allow biomarkers to be notified on the image so they can be very precise in their diagnosis, don't overlook things, and then send their report back to the oncologist. So what we've done, we separated time and place from where the specialist is. And you know, if we can do this for pathology, we can do it for cardiology, we can do it for dermatology. So I believe it's the beginning of a completely new way of practicing medicine where truly supply will meet demand.
I couldn't agree more. I mean, essentially, care is location driven. We go to the cave like 2,000 years ago, and if there is a line, we wait. And if you're lucky enough, you have a great doctor in the cave. This virtualization is much more than not being able to show up in a distance. It's reshuffling and redistributing the care infrastructure so it's much more efficient and much more available to people. It's a true game changer. We almost separate empathy from brains, hands from infrastructure to provide the best possible care and make it available to many more centers. You don't need 15 Hodgkin lymphoma centers in America. You need one that is fantastic, and then make it available to as many people as possible, executed all over the place. This is the reality that we are building, and I can't be more excited to help execute this.
So I think if we even look a little bit further, now we can actually glean information from every interaction, or every discussion between a doctor and a patient, from every diagnosis, which is grounded in this longitudinal view of the patient and the efficacy of the prescribed treatment. So if we start building in those feedback loops and we start becoming way more granular in the diagnosis and the therapy as a consequence, I think we can also really raise the bar on the quality of care. You know, how do you see that?
Well, obviously, I totally agree. I mean, we've seen those revolutions before. If you look at a great Dutch company called ING, that reinvented online banking, you're going to see online care is a very powerful change in the way that we consume care. And it's what not what you think necessarily. Give you a strange example. We have a little client in the Middle East, a million member staff model HMO, that couldn't afford to build more practices. And instead of trying to chip in $100 million more to build a few more practices that couldn't change dramatically the convenience of access to their doctors, they're now investing in a technology that will create a digital health plan. And like ING, the basic idea is simple. We're going to connect to all the doctors through their EMR and flow them into the cloud. We're going to connect to all the consumers through the website and apps and make all the members be able to connect to all their doctors nationwide. So now you go online, instead of waiting a few hours, you wait a few minutes, and if you need a referral to the hospital, it's available for you electronically, and if you need a lab result, a phlebotomist will come to your home. It's a big change in the way that this little health plan is exercising it, and already we see a dramatic transition in their positioning in the market just by doing that. You're going to hear many of those stories available anytime soon. This morning at 9 a.m., we announced a partnership with Jocelyn Diabetes. It's a small organization. There are about 200 doctors in this organization. But it's one of the best in the world in treating diabetes. There is no way 200 doctors could be available to more patients unless you find a way to amplify their services. Imagine the know-how available to many more people through a joint platform of Philips and American Well. How many diabetics can we help manage with those type of resources?
Yeah, I think these are very exciting examples. I'm personally in discussion with a very large hospital network in Brazil, where they're looking at creating a complete new virtual world, almost like primary care, because there's not very sophisticated primary care. So this is the first time they can create a whole infrastructure for primary care, which is linked through the network to their specialist hospitals. So I think we're at the beginning of something really big, and I'm really excited to do it together with you, Ido, and your team. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much, Jeroen.
Thanks.
It's a pleasure.